complex issues that we are tackling in the Middle East. But today it really comes down to one simple question. Will we prevent Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons capabilities? I don't think any of us are under the illusion that a satisfactory and comprehensive deal will be reached on Monday. But let me be clear. Any deal must cut off all of Iran's pathways to a nuclear weapon, and this specifically includes the Iraq reactor. A deal must dismantle Iran's centrifuge program to prevent Iran from becoming a threshold nuclear state, create robust verification and monitoring mechanisms to prevent undetectable breakout, force Iran to come clean on its past nuclear activities, including impossible military dimensions, and cover a long enough duration that the regime won't simply wait it out. In the absence of a deal on Monday, we could be left with alternative outcomes, either an extension of talks under the current terms, or a framework agreement with details to be addressed in the future negotiations, or final recognition that the clerics running Iran never intended to make a deal at all. Any suggestion that talks should be extended must include verifiable mechanisms to prevent Iran from covertly advancing its nuclear program. Madam Chairman, I can't stress enough to our negotiators in Vienna and our P5+1 partners how seriously we take the implementation of a strict verification and monitoring process. This regime has unfortunately proven itself untrustworthy time and time again. We've uncovered covert nuclear facilities. We've discovered military dimensions to its nuclear program, the development and testing of ballistic missiles, the arms shipped to terrorist groups, all in direct violation of United Nations Security Council resolutions. If an extension is suggested, it must be for a clearly defined and limited time. Iran cannot be allowed to negotiate in perpetuity, dragging things out while continuing to receive sanctions relief in exchange for incremental baby steps. The current status quo will not be the accepted new normal. Now is the time for Iran to take significant steps to show the world once and for all whether or not it is serious. And if an extension is proposed, Congress should make clear to Iran that sanctions will be ratcheted up dramatically at the expiration of an extension period. This will finally make Iran understand the ramifications of failing to yield on its pursuit of a nuclear weapon. And while the world has been focused for the past year on nuclear negotiations, this regime has continued to engage in the most egregious human rights abuses against its own people, something that we hear too little about. Make no mistake, deal or no deal, we will not overlook Iran's abysmal human rights record. Yesterday, the United Nations issued a strong rebuke to the regime on human rights, adopting a resolution criticizing Iran's, and I quote, alarming high frequency and increase in the death penalty, widespread restrictions on basic freedoms, and worsening discrimination and persecution of women and minorities. This regime, during the Rouhani presidency, has executed over 850 people in the past 15 months. This includes 12 executions in one prison over 11 days in October. Religious minorities, women, and the LGBT community continue to be persecuted. Access to free press and the Internet is blocked. Communications are monitored, and people are detained for expressing dissent toward regime policies. Iran has not fulfilled its promises of assistance in our efforts as well to find my constituent, Robert Levinson, who has now been missing and separated from his wife, children, and grandchildren for 2,813 days. It has not released the other Americans imprisoned, or Washington Post journalist Jason Rezaian, who has been held without charges for over 120 days. This regime may no longer have the bombastic spokesman Ahmadinejad to incite anti-Semitism and spew vitriol, but that hasn't stopped the Supreme Leader from issuing just recently a 9-point plan on why and how Israel should be annihilated. It hasn't stopped the regime's unabated support for the murderous Assad regime, or its relentless support for Hezbollah's terrorism around the world. It hasn't stopped its meddling in Iraq, in Yemen, in Bahrain, and other Gulf countries. Look, I want to see a diplomatic solution to the nuclear crisis. The best resolution would be to reach a comprehensive deal that addresses all of the points that I laid out earlier. But even if a nuclear deal is reached, Iran must know that its behavior will not be accepted by responsible nations. We will speak out against the regime's barbaric treatment of its own people. We will continue to enforce sanctions on those who perpetuate these abuses, and we will continue to go after the regime's financial and military support of terrorist organizations. I know we're all anxiously awaiting Monday's deadline, And I'd just like to repeat what we have heard from the administration since day one. No deal is better than a bad deal. A bad deal will gravely threaten the safety and security of the United States, of our allies in the region, especially Israel. And, Madam Chairman, let me be clear about one last thing. Those of us who may question the merits of an inadequate deal are not on a march and do not advocate a march to war. We simply do not want to see an agreement that allows Iran to acquire a nuclear weapon right under our noses. Again, I thank our witnesses for appearing today. You each bring unique expertise and insight into Iran's domestic and foreign policy, and I look forward to a productive discussion. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deutch. And now I will